Hello.
Hello.
We put together this presentation, and as a short introduction, I wanted to show these two issues of the Beatles book, because...
That's October 1968 and May 1969 we're looking at.
That. Yeah. It had a segment called Beatle Pen Pals, and it's something really connected to the 60s that you could write Beatle Pen Pals. I would like to point out that my name was in print 7 issues before yours.
Yes. And you didn't claim to be half, did you?
No.
You weren't 17 and a half, you were just 17. You know what I mean?
I know. So we could have become pals then.
We
but
could.
But we didn't.
Yeah. We became pals in 1986 instead. And this was one of our first research expeditions down to Weston-super-Mare in the west of England. Why are we standing like that?
Because the Beatles were there in July 1963, and these are such important photographs that traveled all over the world, and we were very curious. Where was these?
You were more curious than me.
Yeah, but I went along on for the ride.
I was the driver, but you turned me on to the idea of going to places where the Beatles had been and having your photograph taken where they had were taken, not just to be a fan, although we were fans, but to learn something, to learn about the process of how it was taken and where it was taken and so on. So that's why we're standing like that.
But now we go back to 1960,
yes,
and the first trip to Hamburg, which took them across the channel for the first time. They're going abroad.
They were going abroad, and they were going from Liverpool to Hamburg, and they were going in this Morris minibus owned by the Beatles' short-term manager, Alan Williams, without whom this would not have happened. Hamburg happens because of him, and the Beatles happen really because of Hamburg. So he was vital. And in those days, there were no roll-on, roll-off ferries. You couldn't drive on a ferry and drive off. Your ferry had to be winched up by a crane and lowered into the cargo hold of the boat. And this is at Harwich. And on the left, you can see John Lennon in the glasses there. There he is, watching with fear, because all their equipment and luggage is stowed on top of the bus. And if there was an accident, they could have lost everything. And there it is in midair. And so we wanted to find out exactly what was the transport. We've seen a bad picture of it, but here it is. That's really the vehicle they were in, a cream and green Morris minibus.
And this is the interior.
Yeah.
Without the seats, but you can see where the seats would have been. And they were running the length of the vehicle.
Yeah, down the left and the right-hand side. So they all sat opposite one another with their feet in the middle. And this was 1,000 kilometers from Liverpool to Hamburg. And the van, the bus, could not go fast because it was so heavily laden and it was old and only had a 1500cc engine. So they made their way slowly across the Netherlands in this.
So they crossed the channel, and that was the Hook of Holland, Harwich.
Harwich on the east coast of England to the Hook van Holland on the west coast of the Netherlands.
And this map, even though it's from 1893, shows the whole journey from Liverpool all the way to Hamburg.
Yeah, simple as that.
And this is what they see as they arrive in the early morning at 6 a.m.
The Beatles' first sight in the Netherlands is this building.
The terminal building of Hoek van Holland.
Yeah.
And when they get inside, they get into the customs area.
Yes.
Where they have to have some delay.
There was a story of them being held up to 4 hours. We think actually now on reflection, it was maybe 2. They were masquerading as students because the owner of the club in Hamburg had not arranged work permits for them. So they were going in, coming in as students, but they had all these electric guitars and amplifiers. And the Dutch immigration authorities wondered if they were going to sell them and were trying to charge them import duty. So they were held up for a while in that hall. So they, what view have they had of Dutch people to begin with is probably not a very kind one. But customs officers are not always the nicest of people to meet when you first arrive somewhere.
And then they had to present their passports for the very first time. Some of the passports were acquired just 2 days before.
Yes, just days before. They had never been abroad before, so they had to get passports to go to Hamburg. And these are they. And that's John Lennon's passport. You can see that it says student initially. It was crossed out later and changed to musician.
And there's Paul's.
There's Paul's, a photocopy I had there, and George's, supplemented by a later photograph of him looking like Hard Day's Night George.
Yeah.
Initially like a boy, which he was. He was 17 years old when he first came through the Netherlands.
And the visa pages are interested because they show the stamps and the entry and exit dates, and some of them were quite surprising.
And the very first stamp is a Dutch stamp, which I think is quite nice.
And so they had to travel by this bus.
Yeah, all the way.
All the way.
So
to Hamburg.
What was their route? We've been trying to work out what their route was based on evidence of certain stories or pictures and so on.
I've been to a library and got car maps from the area from 1960. They're not much different, actually, from today's, except that the names of the roads have changed. But I think basically they use the road called E36, which takes them through Rotterdam and then up to Utrecht and just east to Hamburg, in the direction of Hamburg,
Yeah. Basically. Yeah.
Someone wrote, I think maybe Alan Williams said that they wanted to go to Amsterdam, which doesn't make sense, but maybe they were curious about Amsterdam.
They probably were, but it doesn't look like they went there. They may have had the idea of it, but not go there. But what they did do was...
stop in Rotterdam.
Go to Rotterdam.
Yeah. They may have stopped just to get some more petrol.
Yeah. That's not their vehicle.
No, just a period picture.
But it is a picture of a minibus like theirs stopping at a Dutch petrol station in those days, to give you an idea.
But there's also a story told by Alan Williams, which was reported in a Dutch newspaper in 1970. And it said that in Liverpool, this journalist talked to Alan Williams, and Alan Williams said, "Look, I've got a very interesting item," and he took it out of his pocket, and it was a photograph of the Beatles taken in Rotterdam.
Yeah.
And he said that we were stuck in Rotterdam and we posed for an important war memorial. And this picture is, if somebody wants to buy it, it's 10,000 guilders.
Yes.
That's what the newspaper said.
Yes.
Have you seen this picture?
No, I've never seen the picture. I don't think anybody has seen the picture. It's lost. The Dutch journalist thought that 10,000 guilders was a lot of money. This was 1970, it was a lot of money. So he didn't buy it. He wrote that he had seen it, but he didn't buy it. And then Alan Williams lost it. He lost quite a few things in those days. He also lost a very precious recording that he had of the Beatles on their first visit to Hamburg. So this is a picture, and it actually would be the first ever picture of the Beatles as the Beatles. And he lost it. But
the statue where they would have posed was this one, a very famous statue from Worcesterstadt, destroyed city, made by Ossip Zadkine.
Yeah.
So the picture might have looked something like this.
Yeah. So now we've seen it, right?
Mm. So on they went from Rotterdam east to Utrecht, and they maybe should have turned north to Amersfoort and beyond, but they didn't. They turned southeast towards Oosterbeek. And some say this was a mistake or they took the wrong turn, but we now think it was intentional.
Yes.
Because Alan Williams had a specific purpose.
Yeah, he had a cousin. I mean, Oosterbeek and Arnhem, of course, was the scene of a terrible battle in 1944 towards the end of the war, but it was a very big battle and a tremendous loss of life, particularly on the Allied side. And Alan Williams had a cousin who had been injured in that battle and who himself had friends who had been killed in it. And there was opened in 1945, 1 year after the battle at Arnhem, a particular war cemetery for the Allies. 1,764 men buried in that cemetery at Oosterbeek. And Alan wanted to go there to pay his respects to the fallen soldiers of 1944, which really wasn't that much before 1960, only 16 years before the events of the Beatles passing by. So they went to this cemetery, which is still there to this day and completely unchanged.
So this was where this first picture of the Beatles together was taken.
The second picture, perhaps, if the Rotterdam was the first one, but this becomes the first one that we have, the earliest picture of the Beatles as the Beatles. John Lennon not in the picture. Alan did say in one of his books that John Lennon was so upset at the sight of all these war graves. He was so angry at the futility of war, that he didn't want any part of this. But it could just be that he just wasn't in the picture. Maybe he was off doing something else, I don't know. But this picture is taken, it's the first thing you see when you walk into the cemetery. A grouping on the left, Alan Williams is the man in the beard. If not for him, none of this is happening. Beryl Williams, his wife, is standing behind him in the open neck shirt. Sitting on the memorial is their West Indian friend, Lord Woodbine, real name Harold Phillips. And Stuart Sutcliffe, the Beatles bass player, is standing up in the dark glasses there. And they really know, the Williamses know the Beatles through Stuart. They're friendly with Stuart more than they are with John, Paul, George, and their brand new drummer, Pete, the first ever picture of Pete Best with the others, is this one here.
And one of the things you wanted to do in the Netherlands while you're here is go visit the site.
Yeah, I did.
So we went there yesterday.
We were there yesterday in that horrible weather. It was freezing cold. It was pouring with rain, but we went there with Anna and with Vibo.
And so it was not the best circumstance, but
no,
it was still good to see exactly where they were.
Yes.
And so we took a group picture.
Yeah. And I'm being Stuart because he is my favorite Beatle. Yes.
And then there's the story about the music shop.
Yes. Now, we didn't go there yesterday because the shop is now gone, but this is the shop where the Beatles, I think after they left Oosterbeek, they went into Arnhem. Maybe they were looking for provisions or for lunch or something like that. And they went into this music shop. And in that music shop, an item left the shop without being paid for. Shall we say, John Lennon slipped this harmonica into his pocket and stole it from the shop.
And he might have used it later to provide entertainment in the car.
I expect he did it in the minibus, yes. And as Alan Williams said, are you mad? You know, you were already posing as students and now you've gone and stolen something. We could get into trouble here, but they got away with it and carried on their journey.
So they continue on from Arnhem, going east, northeast, and they cross the border, passing Denenkamp, the last place in the Netherlands, and past the border at Nordholm, and they go to Hamburg.
They're into Germany.
And this is their first day
there. Yeah, the whole purpose of all that adventure, those 1,000 kilometers on the road, was to lead to this. This is the Beatles on their opening night in Hamburg. They are about to have their lives completely transformed by this Hamburg experience. They don't know it yet. They're young, they're inexperienced, their equipment is poor, but they're keen, and this is the start of it. And all those road miles were to make this moment happen.
So they're there in August.
Yes.
And their stay is until December.
Yes, it wasn't expected to be so long, but it got renewed and extended while they were there, and they ended up staying into December. But it all ended in disarray. The next thing is...
Well, we got the date that George leaves.
Yeah, George is found to be underage. He was already underage, but they weren't taking a look at that. But suddenly it was exposed that he was 17. He wasn't even meant to be in the clubs, let alone working in the clubs. So he was deported from Germany. And George had to make the journey back from Hamburg across the Netherlands and back to England all on his own.
So this stamp says Oldenzaal, which was the port of entry if you go from Germany to Holland by train.
Which he did.
And that's where the border control is.
Yeah.
We've got a picture of the border control. Yeah. And it might be that the very men.
Perhaps.
It might be that Joop Rump put the stamp in George's passport.
George would have enjoyed being stamped by someone called Rump.
And this was the station as it looked then.
Yes.
So that he travels
across the
country and catches the ferry.
Yes. I'm feeling very sorry for himself because he thought that when he got back to Liverpool, he would be the only Beatle there and the others were all having a good time in Hamburg without him. He little knew that Paul and Pete were deported as well, but they were sent home by the German authorities by plane. And they actually got back before George did. So when he got back, he was delighted to find that they weren't having a great time without him. There were actually more Beatles in Liverpool now than there were in Hamburg.
And John stays for a few more days in Hamburg, but then the stamp says on the 7th, he leaves as well.
He also comes back on the train carrying his new Rickenbacker guitar, which he's bought on that trip. and also an amplifier as well. He's completely laden down, unhappy with his experience, but making his own way back to Liverpool.
And he has to take the train, leaving at 3:50 in the morning.
Yes.
From Hamburg.
Yeah.
And then it goes all the way across the Netherlands.
Stopped at Hengelo, Utrecht, Gouda,
Rotterdam, Hoek van Holland.
Yes.
So he can catch the day ferry.
Yes. Did anybody here see any of these Beatles passing through by any chance? No.
So it gets him into London at 8:30 at night, and then he has to travel across London to Euston Station and catch the train up to Liverpool, where he arrives.
After midnight, and he has to throw stones up at Aunt Mimi's bedroom window to get her to come down and let him in. And of course, she comes down and starts shouting at him immediately. And he just storms upstairs and goes to bed.
Then it's 1961.
Yeah. The Beatles want to go back to Hamburg. This time they're doing it without Alan Williams. They're going to get there themselves. And they decide, well, we know how to do it by train. So they do those same journeys now in the direction of Hamburg, again passing through the Netherlands.
So we get an entry stamp again. John's passport in Hoek van Holland.
Yes.
And George's.
Yes, John and George made the trip, just the two of them, because Paul and Pete had been deported and it was unclear whether they would get a permit to work in Hamburg again. But John and George said, well, we're going anyway. So it's an interesting thought that had the permits for Paul and Pete not come through, John and George would have been playing with other musicians in Hamburg and life could have taken a different turn. Yeah. But they arrive at the Hoek of Holland, which I understand the Hoek means the corner.
It does. It is not a hook.
It's not a hook, it's a corner. It just says hook, to confuse me.
And it's the corner of Holland.
Yes, okay.
The corner of South Holland, actually.
Right.
Yeah.
Southwest Holland.
So you could walk straight from the boat, from the quay, into the train.
Yes.
And then it would take you in the opposite direction.
And so they're looking, this is a daytime, isn't it? They're looking out of the window.
Yeah.
I wonder what their impression was of the Netherlands as they passed through it. Flat, isn't it? They probably said.
Yeah.
Isn't it flat? Yeah.
And now they're crossing Holland the border at the German border patrol.
Yes.
At Bad Bentheim. This is how the station at Bentheim looked late 19th century. But it would have looked quite similar in 1960. And as they pass through Bad Bentheim, at the same time, Paul in Liverpool gets his stamp.
Yes.
And he's allowed.
And Pete as well, whose passport we don't have, but it would have looked like this. And so they set off separately a couple of days behind John and George, and they make the same journey across the Netherlands. And the purpose this time is to go to Hamburg to play at the top 10 club on the Reeperbahn. And here's a picture just towards the end of that visit. They were there for 3 months. They played every single day, 7 days a week for 7-8 hours a day. An extraordinary, over 500 hours played in these 3 months alone. And this is the very end of the trip because Paul has his Hofner violin bass guitar and Stuart has his bass guitar as well, bottom left. But Stuart is staying in Hamburg. He's not coming back anymore. He's now at the end of this engagement, leaving the Beatles. And they're going to become a four-piece instead of a five-piece.
Yeah. So now we got a new stamp in John's passport, the 2nd of July. He gets into Holland-Zaal again.
Yeah, and his is representative of all of them. They travel back together this time. They leave Hamburg mid-afternoon and travel across the Netherlands in daylight because it's July, beginning of July.
And then they can catch the night ferry.
They stop at Amersfoort and Utrecht. And they get to the Hoek of Holland in the nighttime, 22:44. And it gets them into London at 9:13. And then they got across London and get the train to Liverpool. They arrive in the afternoon. And that's the end of their second train ride in that direction through the Netherlands. Now, in 62, the Beatles have a new manager, Brian Epstein, who doesn't want them traveling in an undignified way. He says, why don't you fly? But there is no direct flight from Liverpool to Hamburg, so they have to change in Schiphol. So again, they pass through the Netherlands on all three occasions when they fly to Hamburg in 1962. That isn't them in the picture, but it could be, because this is the picture from that period of time.
They would have seen this interior if they had to wait a bit.
They would have seen those three people standing there.
Probably.
Yeah. And here is a picture of the Beatles about to board a plane for Hamburg. I'm not quite sure where it was taken, maybe Liverpool, but possibly Amsterdam as well. Maybe a plane spotter might recognize what plane that is.
So that really ends the story of 1960-62.
Yeah.
We all know that they came here in 64. We don't have to cover that. They also arrived at Schiphol.
Yeah.
I just wanted to show this nice color picture because it was new to me.
So this didn't happen in 1962, but what a difference 2 years can make, because they passed through anonymously through Schiphol in 62 three times. And then in 64, when they land, it's all of this happening.
At the TV show taped at Treslong, they posed for this picture, which is interesting because they hold an credit roll, an actual physical credits roll.
So you know the expression, roll the credits. That is because initially credits were on a roll and someone would be cranking it from the side and then a camera would be trained on it, and that's how we see television credits in those days.
Yes, and the interesting thing here, of course, is that they signed it with white chalk, the physical roll.
Yeah.
And perhaps you in the audience haven't seen the following, which is the original roll.
So here it is. Here's the one that went out. If you were watching television here in 1964, you will have seen this, but otherwise, this is probably a first for you. Ben de Jong was the man in the photograph we just saw. And here are the signatures in chalk. Jimmy Nicol writing bigger than anybody. Yeah. And George Harrison. So that's the four of them. But we took inspiration from this and we thought we would add the credits for our little presentation in the same manner. So this is the end of our presentation. Please watch this for the copyright.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Pete. Thanks.